admiring him and idolizing him in my life. Thank you, Anju, for creating that opportunity for me. It's not a very good time for me in terms of mind is very preoccupied. I come from Kerala, and a big part of my relatives are stuck in some relief camp or other. Most of them are staying in relief camps, and some of them we are not able to contact them for the last 4 days. So it's kind of slightly stressful on the mind, and just this whole night, last night was in a rescue operation, came back only at 4 in the morning, so I'm kind of slightly on the not so great mood thing, so please bear with me if I, because when I'm very stressed, what goes out of my hand is my English, so please bear with me if I'm not able to speak the right English and the right words. I'm here to share with you about victims of human trafficking and their relationship or their connection to the criminal justice system. I would, for the big part of my presentation, focus more on understanding the victims properly and understanding what they go through and what is it that they require from the criminal justice system. Because I think there are, you know, all kinds of people in this August gathering, people who know the law, you know what the Indian system is, what is there and what is not there. I'm not here to tell you what is there and what is not there, but I will tell you the world I know very well. The last 25 years, I have been rescuing children and women from sex trafficking. I have removed around 21,000 women and children out of prostitution. Been not 100% successful in getting them all back into mainstream society, but 85% successful in terms of the numbers that, I'm also a failure in more than 15% of the cases that I've dealt with. So I will be sharing about those failures and those successes of what I know of this world more, and that will be the big part of my thing. Let me start by putting the context clearly before you. The child on my right, she's 9 years old. You can call her Sonu. She's from the Northeast. She's an orphan. At the age of 4, her auntie, her mother's sister, put her in a tea stall to work. At the age of 5, this woman sold this child to a pimp. And for the next 4 years, Sonu has been sold and resold in several brothels across the country. Thousands of men have raped her, and then finally she was dumped in Hyderabad on a highway with acute traumatic brain injuries. Sonu has been with me for the last 4 years and still not come back to normalcy in terms of that's how much of damages that is there in her brain and her mind. On to the left is Rani. She's 12 years old. She comes from Kyonjar district of Orissa. Her father deserted the family very early. Mother was the, you know, heading the household. Some lady whom they knew very, very well, the mother was struggling to take care of the family. Both mother and daughter used to go to the farms to work. So when a very familiar woman came and said, ki, Rani can get a job as a nanny to work in a house. The mother was overjoyed, the daughter also was overjoyed. So mother very happily, willingly handed over her daughter to this lady. This lady was taking this girl. As they were proceeding in the transport, this girl overheard a conversation that this lady was having with somebody. And the conversation was something to the effect, ki fresh maal hai, tum jo de rahe ho, you know, it is not enough. So something in Rani clicked, ki bhai, some danger is there. She thought something is going to happen to her. And at the first available opportunity, when she got a mobile phone in her hand from this lady, she contacted not her mother, because according to Rani, her mother would not understand what she's going through. She contacted her boyfriend. Now, Rani is 12 years old and she has a 22-year-old boyfriend in the village. She contacted him and told him ki meri zindagi khatre mein hai. I'm into trouble. Mere ko ye aurat kuch karne ja rahi hai. And she's taking me somewhere. So this knight in shining armor came. He said, don't worry, be there. You tell me which is the location. I'll come there. I'll rescue you. Rescued this girl and sold her in a brothel in Delhi from Odisha. Rani never came to know for months together that this lady and this boy belong to the same gang. They were spotters put in villages to identify vulnerable families, desperate families, single households. And the first tier was job denge. Wo nahi chalega, to love is the second tier. She came to know that both these people were connected to the same gang after 8 months in a brothel in Delhi. Odisha police rescued this girl. 36 people were arrested in the whole process. I can tell you thousands of stories of children. Last night, I rescued 6 children out of a brothel in close to Hyderabad in a place called as Yadadri with Ratchakonda police. The youngest child was 3 years old from a brothel and the oldest was 7 years old. I was telling Anju before we started the presentation today, I'm still, because the whole night is nightmarish for me, I'm still not able to come in terms with the fact that one of the children had only injection marks all over her body. I don't know why there's that many injection marks were there. Another child had bite marks all over her body. This child is just 4 years old. Thousands of children, both girl children and male children, are sold into sex slavery in our country. Every 10 minutes, according to one statistics, a human being sold in our country. Official statistics says 2 to 3 million. And you know what the official statistics means. It's only the reported cases. For every single case of trafficking that is reported, there is 100 cases which is not reported. That says 2 to 3 million people, that is 30 lakh women and children, of which 45% are children. And as I told you, the youngest child, I don't know, I hope not. Because, 2 years back, I had the unfortunate problem of getting to rape videos on my WhatsApp, which started another PIL in the Supreme Court of circulation of rape videos on social media and online space. And in this 2 years after the CBI has started investigating the case, every Tom, Dick and Harry has been sending me videos from all over the country of Indian girls, Indian children being raped and the videos being circulated. And one of the horrors that I'm going through in my life for the last 2 years is seeing 6 months baby being raped and the video is in circulation. You can see the baby, you can see the person who's doing it, but you don't know where this baby is and you don't know where this man is because the video is circulating everywhere. I just dread that I hope I don't see a 6 month baby in a brothel, catering to the sexual needs of men. But that is the age profile of the human beings who are being sold. It is not just an organized crime. It's also a billion-dollar industry. It means so much of revenue in it. There's so many people earning on it, so many people living on it, so many people sustaining their existing economic existence where human beings can be bought very, very cheaply. But are human beings only sold for prostitution? No. They're sold for various purposes of exploitation. A one-day baby can be sold in the name of adoption. Hundreds of children are sold for organ trade, for labor exploitation, for domestic work, for circus, for beggary, for camel jockeying. But I work on the field of sex trafficking and I might be very biased, and you people like me who are mad in our own way, we are very biased about the work that we do, and maybe we think that is the only biggest thing that is there in the world, and there is no other problem bigger than the problem that we are dealing with. I find the world of sex trafficking as the worst form of human trafficking. For the simple reason that here is a space. In other forms of trafficking, you can identify the victim, and the victim also can identify the person. You know, and say, okay, I'm a victim, please help me, please save me, please, you know, I need support. But in the world of sex trafficking, you have a situation where the victim does not identify herself to be a victim. Even a 10-year-old child might tell you, मैं अपनी मर्जी से कर रही हूँ ना, आपको क्या problem है? ये तो मेरी auntie है. I have a little girl, 11-year-old, whose mother has sold her. Every day she tells me, मैडम मेरी mother कितनी problem में थी आपको पता है? कितने कष्ट में थी आपको पता है? The mother was making her sleep with 12 men a day. Every day 12 men. And she actually, this child actually justifies this and says, you know, कितने कष्ट की वजह से मेरी mother को मेरे साथ ऐसा करना पड़ा. And she actually believes that she's doing help to her family. It is one part of the story, but most of the victims don't even accept that they are victims. And that is why there is a need to understand the victim more clearly. What is that victim? What is the profile of the victim? What is the journey she goes through? And why does she become or start speaking the particular language that she starts speaking? I want to also very, very clearly state at this point that poverty is not the only reason for human trafficking. It's a myth in today's times. With technology, today any human being is vulnerable to be trafficked. In 2015, a huge racket was busted in Hyderabad, the city that I come from, where 189 girls, all between the age of 13 to 16, were trapped through the Facebook. All of them, daughters of IT professionals, doctors, engineers, very middle class, very upper middle class. So thanks to technology, thanks to mobile phones, thanks to internet, thanks to Facebook and so many other technologically enabled services, today it will be very, very foolish for us to say that it is poverty that is leading to human trafficking. Today, we need to understand and acknowledge that each one of us who has a near and dear one is equally vulnerable to be trafficked. Male child or a female child. We work with female children, so I'm giving you examples more and more of the female cases, but please understand there are enough number of boys also getting trafficked. I'd like to very, very quickly take you on a very quick journey of what a victim goes through. I said I want to go take you through this journey because the reason why I started off my mission was because I was so angry. I was gang raped at the age of 15 by 8 men. The rape per se was not such a big deal, if I have to honestly put things in perspective. But what happened after that? The social exclusion, the ostracization, the marginalization, the blaming. Why did you go there? My parents were ostracized. They were socially excluded. There were relatives who would call my family, my parents, and say, you know, there's a marriage in the family, there's a wedding in the family, but please don't come. Aap aoge, so then they will, the Sunita's topic will come, and then everything, mahol will be destroyed. I have experienced how the world victimizes a victim. And that made me so angry and continues to make me angry. And I see the same thing about victims of trafficking too, and especially victims of sex trafficking. There's so much of lack of understanding, especially from stakeholders of the criminal justice system, who are actually part of our own system, our own thinking, our own attitude, on what has this person gone through. Entire blame is on her. She is the one responsible for what happened to her. And therefore, people look at it more from a moral perspective rather than from an organized criminal perspective, that here is a person systematically whose liberty has been taken away from her. Systematically she is indoctrinated to believe that this is what your fate is and this is what you have to do. And so very, very quickly, I'd like to take you on a very quick journey of what a victim goes through. The journey of any victim starts from a very optionless background. And when we say optionlessness, poverty is also one form of optionlessness. Lack of livelihood opportunities is one form of optionlessness. But also poverty of the mind, that is also a form of optionlessness. And you need to understand that too. It is not just abject poverty and starvation that's making people vulnerable. Even if this young girl, who's a Bangladeshi girl, brought here in India, she was murdered inside a brothel. All because she said too much of no. Not all girls go through all this. Sometimes only stories, you know, uske saath falane saath wo kiya, iske saath waisa kiya, hum tumhare saath wo karenge. These are stories that are told, maybe based on one story, and that is how threats and intimidation is done to the person. A young child told me, who was rescued from Baina in Goa, she's 8 years old, she told me that she was kept in a room with a snake for 8 days, till she said, I will do whatever you want me to do. Another girl who was rescued from Budhwar Pet Red Light area told us that they took a blade and cut her on the sides here till she said, stop, stop, stop. I will do whatever you want me to do. I can tell you thousands of stories of how girls are indoctrinated and broken into the whole criminal world. For a person who's trapped there, it is like, I have to get out of this torture. And so when she says yes, she thinks that this is an end to what her torture is going to be. What she doesn't realize is this is the beginning of a lifetime of torture, because most girls who get trapped in sex slavery, as you know, hardly 7% of them ever get rescued. And what is the world of sex slavery we are talking about? We're talking about a system which is fundamentally exploited. There are 5 to 6 to 7 people living on the earnings of one person, for example. I'm here, my brothel keeper, my pimp, my financier, my gundas, maybe the police sometimes, maybe a lawyer sometimes, one whole network of candidates are around me living on my body. And therefore, this body has to be available to that many number of people for the revenue to come to all these 6 or 7 people. I cannot decide, today is a Sunday, I should not sleep with 10 people. Or today, I have my periods, I don't want to have it. Or today is, you know, some festival of mine. I like it, I don't like it, I have to sleep with 10 or 12 people or 40 people, whatever is the numbers they are saying. In Chandrapur, in Vani, some of the places that we rescued, girls told us that they were made to sleep for 45 to 50 men a day. You like it, you don't like it, you're pregnant, your periods, you have anything, everything, you have to sleep. Now, what is the profile of the men who come to sleep? Are these people here to have an accountable relationship with you? Are they coming here to a brothel, willing to spend 500 rupees for a 5-year-old child or a 10-year-old child or a 12-year-old child, because they want to next day look in the morning at the face of the person and say, hi Jan, how are you? Will you have a cup of tea? No. These are people who want your body for a particular purpose, to satisfy their sexual needs. 1 out of 5 men who frequent the brothels want to actualize their fantasies. The stories that our children tell us, they would have at least one customer a day out of the 12 or 13 who will put chili powder in their vagina. There will be at least one customer who will take a blade and cut them. There will be at least one customer who will take a belt and beat them up. I understand, I've traveled across the world, I've been to all the red light areas in the world, including legalized brothels. I haven't heard of this pattern is anywhere else in the world that I've heard so much in India, where I believe men like to bang the head of the person on the bedpost and the walls. The head is banged again and again. And when you ask the children, why do you allow all this to happen? They say, you know, paisa diya na, karna hi hai. There's nowhere it is written that sex is this. This is the only form of sex you can have it here.
If you go to Netherlands, if you go to some other legalized brothels, you will actually see nice whips and blades and knives kept for display. You can buy that form of sex. Here, you do the same thing in an unsterilized, very harmful environment, hurt the person so much, and these little ones have to see that every day. But what do we think? What is the larger world's perception about these children and these girls and these women? Oh, what shortcut, yeah. These girls don't want to work. You know, they are in for an easy life. You know, they don't want to work, and that is why they are doing this. They are all this category. That is our perception, that this is a very lucrative industry. Yes, it is a lucrative industry, and you need to understand that. It is lucrative for the people who run the business. The brothel keepers, the pimps, the brokers, the traffickers, for all of them it's lucrative. It's a low investment, high profit industry. But for the victim, it is the most damaging industry. She doesn't get anything out of it. This child from Odisha, who was sold here in Delhi, the entire cost of selling her and buying her was around 8,000 rupees. She had to clear back the debt. 8,000, you multiply by some amount that was told to her. Okay, every day you have to do all this. You have to clear this debt because humne itne paisa kharch karke tumko kharida hai. And what is the journey of this paisa? Day one, I'm 12, I'm 13. No man wants to have sex with me with a condom, and therefore he will have unprotected sex with me, therefore I could be pregnant. Now pregnancy is something that I cannot handle with prostitution, so there is, I have to go and get it aborted. Now imagine going to a government hospital with this body where there is blade marks, cigarette marks, scratch marks, all kinds of marks on your body. Any doctor would say something has happened to her. So what is preferred? Preferred is a quack. You're charging some 5,000, 6,000 rupees with a normal hospital. The quack will charge you 30, 40,000 rupees outside. That is also added to her debt. Perpetually, she is clearing her debt. In between all this, she gets, there is a raid or some funny thing in the brothel. Police pick her up, take her. Who will come and claim her from the protective home? Find the claimant to her, whatever amount is spent for that whole thing in the court, all that is also added in the debt. So for lifetime she is clearing her debt. But what does she get for herself? She gets a whole world of diseases. Sexually transmitted infections, reproductive tract infections, cervical damages, traumatic brain injuries, HIV AIDS. She has to drink alcohol. She has to take drugs, for the simple reason that you can't be sleeping with 12 or 13 men a day and doing all kinds of antics on the bed if you are not intoxicated. Over a period of time, you're a substance abuser, you're an alcoholic too. That is the extra bonus that you get. Any girl, day one, she resists being into the situation. Day two, she resists. Day three, she resists. Day four, she says, no choice, I have to get in. Day 7, day 8, she starts realizing, if I'm going to be very hostile to all these people around me, I'm going to get a bad deal. A really bad deal. The worst of the customers are going to be sent to me. I'm going to be beaten up. I'm not going to be given good food. I'll be treated very badly. So what is my situation? What is my choice? I have to start surviving in this space. So the brothel keeper becomes my auntie, meri mausi, meri didi. A pimp will become my mard because that will give me added protection. Mera mard ban gaya. You know, he's taking care of me. He's loving me. He's taking care of me. I'm creating a space for myself inside the whole thing. A day comes. She also is told 100 times, dekho, tumko agar pakad lete hain, you'll be put in a home. You'll be, you know, really destroyed there. You're going to be in a jail. You're going to be destroyed. All that is also told to her. Many of the things that she's told is not untrue. It's actually not untrue. Because the world outside has not given anything better, right? Tell me how many states in India has actually a rehabilitation policy for any victim of trafficking? What is government of India's budget for anti-trafficking intervention or for rehabilitation, you have not created any exit option. You have not created any package for these people to come out. She also knows this. She also knows that what these brothers are saying is perhaps very, very true. And to the fact also that her own family might not accept her. This young girl that we rescued 3 years back died last month of AIDS. Her only wish, 15 days before she died, was when I went to see her, yes, madam, please call my parents. I want to meet my parents. I called the parents. They says, nahi, nahi, humare liye to mar gayi ladki. She's dead for us. We fell at their feet. We physically went and fell at their feet, saying that please, come at least once, we will pay for your travel, we will do everything, please come and at least see her face, because that's her last wish. This is Naini. People will start questioning. You know, we have two other daughters, what about them? This is the kind of rejection that families give. She knows all that. And that is why she starts normalizing the world of exploitation. A day comes when the trafficker is not comfortable with this person, knows that she is not going to be a threat to her or threat to him, becomes very comfortable, is also earning very well. First time the girl is given some money, some 200 rupees, 300 rupees. First time currency comes into her hand. Another few days later, a few months later, the trafficker says, listen, you're now getting 200 per day. You might actually get 20,000. Why don't you go back to Hyderabad? Or to Coimbatore, or to Maharashtra, wherever you came from, go back and get two more girls. Now this girl comes back to her village, maybe in Andhra or Telangana or somewhere else, very good looking, very nice looking, with all the jim jim jil jil dress and everything. Says, you know, I've got a nice job in Delhi, mein bahut acha job hai mera to. You know, wahan pe two more vacancies are there. Just imagine the situation in a village. Arun Lakshmi, I know this person. She's not a stranger. She's not somebody unknown to me. If you've got such a good job, get my daughter also one more job, no? I'm sending this person in the hands of somebody I know and care. That's how this Lakshmi, from being a victim, slowly starts moving towards becoming a procurer of a crime, a perpetrator of crime. It's very important for us to reflect at this point. Who's responsible in making hundreds of Lakshmis perpetrator of crime? Is there some role that all of us are playing as civil society, as stakeholders within the system and outside the system, in actually creating a hostile world for these people to come out and to have a space for recovery and dignity? Just for you to reflect. As you reflect on that, I want you all to look at this girl's face. She was sold at the age of 13 by her own brother-in-law. This picture was taken 15 minutes before she died. She was sold in a place called as Bhiwandi in Mumbai and then resold to another place. We found her at the age of 16, after 3 years after being raped and, you know, violated in several brothels. At the age of 16, when we brought her out, she had all kind of complications of HIV. She had all opportunistic infections already started. She had brain TB, bone TB, blood TB, all in the same person. She survived for 3 years. At the age of 19, she died. But before she died, half an hour before she died, she told the doctors to call me. I have this unique case of this child, two girls sold by their own mother, middle class family. The older girl is 11 years old. The younger one is 9 years old. The older one, 11 year old, is appearing to be recovering. Whereas the younger one, which is 9 year old, has this fetish for putting safety pins inside her body. She takes a safety pin, just pokes it in and inserts it inside her body every time. 8-9 times. Every time you have to surgically remove it out. Not all of them behave the same way. There are different people. Each one is unique, and therefore any intervention cannot be like one package deal. Okay, I have tailoring, all of you learn tailoring. I will show you candle making, so all of you learn candle making. This is all. This is the only solution for coming out. It doesn't happen like that. We need to understand that one glove will not fit for all. Each particular human being has a unique journey of being exploited, violated, and the damage they go through. In this context, what is the safest way to get them back to the society? Keeping them in isolation in homes, that is not the answer. One world of exploitation you take and keep them in another world which you think is safe. They have equal rights like you and me to come back to the society. So how will that reintegration back to the society happen? What is that channel that you will create? These are consideration for people within the criminal justice system, starting from the police to the judiciary and the whole set of people who come in contact with this person after she is rescued. From our own little experience, and I say little experience because millions are being trafficked, I am giving you examples of 20,000. That is cannot be the, you know, the 100% Bible or truth of what is happening. From the little minimum world that I know, it takes minimum of 3 months, a minimum, it can be more, for a person even to acknowledge that she's a victim. I have had situations where a person has not given her real name even after 8 months and 9 months. I have right now a situation where after 1.5 years, this girl is very quietly now telling me that she's a Bangladeshi. For 1.5 years, she has given me a whole address in Chaubis Bargana. I have actually done a home investigation also in that place. I have done, meaning she has given me a whole lot of things, and I've actually done everything. So particularly 100% convincing what she said. After 1.5 years, very sweetly and nicely, she's telling me, I don't belong to this country at all. I come from another country. That's sometimes as much time it takes even to get that basic trust in the people who are providing you care. It takes another 3 months for even gaining the basic life skills to come back to society. And this is soft, silly, small things that I would say. It might sound very silly, but to us who are working there, it is something very big. For all of us who are women in this room, from our childhood, we are taught what is being a woman. You know, we are taught how to stand, how to sit, how to carry ourselves in every public place. We are not taught to sit like this, right? We are not taught to stand like this, right? We are taught that, you know, you have to stand in a particular way. This is the right way to stand. So, achhe ladki ho, achhe ghar ki ladki ho, so you have to be like this. And then you go to another situation and a space where you're told to keep your legs far apart. Stand like this, look like this, because your job is to attract people, right? Your job is to get as much attention to your body and gain that. A whole new body language is created. One of the biggest blocks that we have found when we are working with these people, with these children and these girls, is they kind of get used to a certain body language. And slowly bringing them into normal body language becomes one of the challenges. But to give you a very small example, there are 100 other examples in terms of language, social skills, anger management, a whole lot of life skills that is required. It takes another 6 to 8 months for them to understand whether they want to get into education, whether they want to get into livelihood training, what will work for them. Just all this chota mota things together will take at least a minimum of 1 year. A minimum of 1 year for a person to start even thinking of recovery and starting the road back to dignity. This is something the criminal justice system needs to understand. And what are the challenges before them to as they understand all this? What are the biggest challenges? Challenge number one is hundreds of people will come as claimants as soon as the rescue is done. From 30th of July till last night, we have rescued 26 children from a place called as Yadadri. This is a small red light area with around 100 women in prostitution from a particular caste group called as Dumara. They have been kidnapping children from neighborhood, from all over the places. From 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, small babies have been kidnapped. They are kept in these brothels, groomed for prostitution. Now, after the rescue is over, these 26 children are in my house, in my shelter. And in the last 15 days, we've had not less than 600 people coming, claiming for these children. Everybody is claiming. People have gone to the court. People have come with Aadhaar card, ration card, everything. Finally, the court has taken a decision for DNA test. Yesterday, the reports of the DNA test have come through, and all of it says that none of the DNAs match. Now, this is about children, but I can tell you about even young women and young adults. The number of claimants, my daughter, my sister, my husband, and many a times, the family also could be traffickers. Genuinely, the family has sold this person. The parents themselves have sold this thing. That's also a challenge for them. Challenge is also a whole lot of, and I say this as a chota mota activist, in the court, the problem that we face is a whole lot of advocates who come on behalf of the claimants, from heart attacks happening in the court to, you know, child is dying to everybody dying in the family. All kinds of drama is enacted before the magistrate. You know, we need the girl. You know, the family will crash. All these dramas is a big challenge for the criminal justice system. Apart from that, very difficult to differentiate between a victim and an accused. In a given rescue, it becomes very, very difficult. We have a very, very weak district probation system. We also, to our utter tragedy, have very, very poor shelter homes. Safe home is a necessity, but how safe are the homes in India is a big question mark. Insufficient, inefficient, both of it from this scale to that scale, that is a reality before the criminal justice system. Just showing you a picture of this young person, one of the biggest traffickers between India and Bangladesh. She's 21. At the age of 21, she's already trafficked 93 people. There's lookout notice for her from Interpol and things like that. She could easily pass off as a victim. Very easily pass off as a victim. She just has to insert herself in any rescue operation. This is how difficult it is to intercept the whole thing of trafficking. So what do we require from the criminal justice system? Is to understand the entire perspective and to understand the law from a victim's perspective. If we can keep victim as central to our thinking and apply the law in a way that it benefits the victim and not acts against the victim, that will be the biggest requirement that we need from stakeholders and duty bearers in the criminal justice system. We need to understand that the law is there, there is enough laws in our country. How do we apply that in a way that all the duty bearers are functioning in the right way? If a duty bearer is responsible for the secondary victimization of a victim, please understand that is a bigger crime than the crime committed by the traffickers themselves, because that takes her complete faith away from the entire criminal justice system. Very, very quickly, our response as an organization has been on the prevention, protection, and prosecution front. We have worked at the end of supply to rescue girls. We've also worked on the front of demand by working with men who are, in our opinion, the demand for sex trafficking. We engage with men, and Anju already told you that we run a program called as Men Against Demand. But we also look at working with the criminal justice system as a means of prevention. Only conviction can get better deterrence. We recognize that. We've also been running safe shelters. Not so great, but in the country of blind, we perhaps are the one-eyed king. And also worked with courts and the police to make a victim-centric approach in investigations and in the judicial system. We've been advocating for rehabilitation from a very non-conventional point of view. We have children who are now doing medicine, law, pharmacy, chartered accountancy. We have young women working as welders, carpenters, fabricators, security guards. we don't allow too much of publicity around these things. We don't take these people around, but you can see them. There are also young girls working as television camera assistants in big channels and things like that. These are young girls trained as security guards working in different multinational companies as female security guards. I think as I conclude, all that I would like to request you all to reflect upon is, where are we? Are we part of the problem? And do we actually want to become part of the solution? And as we mull over that question, I want you to reflect back with the story I started. Maybe for you, you have seen thousands of people, you know, in your own life, and you have seen hundreds and thousands and millions of people of the world. But for this person, when she comes in contact with you, as a lawyer, as a judge, as a police officer, you are the world for her. If we can understand that and try to make that thing, because we need to find a way to respond things and respond rightly. Because no child, no human being, no woman deserves what these people go through in this thing. With that, I'd like to conclude.